to wear glasses. So, hi. I think most of you has been in a situation that you was installing a server manually, that you have to get some big document, type in all the commands, and get some piece of software running on some server. Like this old books, just typing over commands. And then some hours later, you have to install an update. And again, you log in on that server and type some commands. And if you're lucky, everything was running and was fine, and you was happy and your customers are happy. And then, of course, everything is okay. You go on holiday and the server is crashing. And your colleagues are there and have no clue where to start. And similar situations I have been in not more than 1 year ago. So my name is Nick Palm, working for Philips, Philips Research, and we were looking for a way how we can go forward on these topics. So of course, infrastructure as code. So a little bit more than 1 year ago, we were in a situation that we have to run all kinds of services in the cloud. And how do you go to manage that? I just go to the Amazon console and install everything manually, or do you go in a smart array? And there are many tools already, and I think very good tools like Ansible, Chef, Puppet. But those tools are a little bit more meant to do configuration. And we were looking for a more simple way, in our opinion, a way that we can just trash our servers, a way that our infrastructure becomes immutable. And therefore, we took a direction in immutable infrastructure. So important, you can think about immutable infrastructure in an infrastructure that you can literally trash. So you can just remove your server, spin up everything again, and then it should be working, and it is fine. And one important piece in that concept that we use there is that our components are immutable. So we focus on having immutable components that we can just literally spin up in our infrastructure, maybe inject some database URLs and those kind of things, and then they are just working. So we don't do any configuration anymore on our components. And tools that fits in quite well are, for example, AMIs that you build with Packer, or they can be Docker images, which is just Docker technology. And since we're working in a research organization, we don't have something like one platform that we can always trust on, because we are want to have an environment where we're not bounded to one technology. And we have some crazy researchers that's still working with MATLAB. That's not just spinning up a simple jar in Cloud Foundry. And so there are all kinds of things. And sometimes it is just easy in Java, and that's fine, but other times it is just MATLAB. So we choose the direction to go for Docker containers and Docker images. And till now, I think we serve already for infrastructures for more than 25 projects. So for us, it works quite good. So to create this infrastructure, you need immutable components, artifacts. And for those artifacts, I think all of you, most of you know that, that is setting up your build pipelines, having version control in place. So of course we have version control, where all code is. Then we have automated builds to automate our build process, so they become reproducible. And for developers, it's maybe normal, but if you're in a research organization, it's not for everyone normal. So they also have to learn on that part. And then you have your automated build, and that's great. But then your versions are not locked because you have all kinds of JavaScript kiddies. They just add everything with NPM, and each time you run the build, you get another result. So it's still not predictable. So you still have to learn everyone to lock down their versions. And we do even that not only for the build, we do that even for the build system as well. So the build system that we use is Docker again, and there all versions of the dependent libraries are locked down as well. So we have version control, we have automated build, where we build in all kinds of quality checks as well, testing, it depends on the project, and then we have locked down the versions. So in the end, we can just ship simply always Docker containers. And that's fine. And then we have to create an infrastructure. And therefore, we select the tool Terraform. And Terraform is a little bit different comparing to, in my, as far as I know, most other tools. They start the same way, you write. So you write simple your code in Terraform. And then the next phase you can do is plan. And in the planning phase, you run a kind of dry run. So you see what change will go to happen in your infrastructure. And it can something be that things are added or even changed or destroying. And they also, the next step after planning is that you literally execute your change. So that is what they call an apply. And besides that apply, they also provide a command to destroy your whole infrastructure at once. And that's also very handy because our projects are sometimes for a year or more, but also sometimes only for 2 months or even shorter. So if you have to, we also need a way that we can easily destroy our software. So what we do now with Terraform is, I think we support last year 20 projects with just a development team with 10 persons where we all do all the development as well. So I go a little bit more in depth about Terraform. So in Terraform, everything is called a resource that you want to manage in your infrastructure. So if you want to think about resource, you can think about it's something that you define as an AWS instance. Can also be a security group, a load balancer, but it's not only AWS. We use AWS because we don't have a choice in our cloud, but they support also other clouds. Most examples that you see are bounded to AWS. And besides clouds, they support resources that you can create even in GitHub repository or in database in PostgreSQL. So that is the providers are the components in Terraform that manage the life cycle of your resources. So with the provider defines the resources that are available, and Terraform supports many different providers. There are just a few on this slide, but if you look up on the Terraform page, you will see there will be even a lot more. And you can split them in a couple of categories. So you have a category that's more the cloud platforms, infrastructure as a service. You have the platform as a service, like Heroku. And then you have other kind of tools, which is more like software as a service. So Docker, GitHub, queuing systems, and so on. But for now, I will focus a little bit more on the AWS part. So other two simple concepts, I think quite common in most languages, is that you have kind of variables. There are two kind of variables to keep in mind. There are the input variables, things that you can define. So you can just specify a variable in one place and use it on many places. Because many resources, for example, needs to know in which Amazon region the resource needs to be added. Yeah, you only want to define it at one place. The other piece is the output variable. And the output variable is something that's calculated by Terraform. So if you create your infrastructure, things that are only calculated after you create it are, for example, the name of the load balancer. So you can find back the URL of the load balancer or the zone ID of your hosted zone. So those kind of things becomes output variables and you can use them everywhere. So writing that code, you do in HCL, that's the HashiCorp configuration language, which really focus, again, it's the same as Puppet, Chef, excuse me, as being very friendly for developers, so very readable. And that's also what we experience. We start using Terraform 1.5 years ago or so, and we see that all developers that are onboarding our teams are, it's very easy for them to understand what's happening, how they can add things, how they can change things. So the language is really human readable. Of course, it is also understandable for a computer because it needs to be executable. It's also declarative. So here we see a simple example for spinning up an AWS instance. So we see here, of course, the resource name that we define, we give an alias, and then we can define properties or attributes that are part of the resource. Resources have mandatory and optional attributes, and attributes you can give variables like string, booleans, lists, and maps. And you can pass through variables as well. So that's writing the code. That's the most important part for writing code. The next phase is the planning phase, the phase that we want to see what's going to happen in our cloud. So during the planning phase, Terraform uses statefile where it keeps track of the state of your resources in your cloud. And during the planning phase, it is just updating the state file according to your cloud and checking which changes it will do in your cloud. And if you're okay with the plan, then you can execute the plan, and that's applying. And that is creating those resources in your cloud environment and then updating the state file as well. So, hello world, because I'm a developer and I like hello world. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spin up a simple web application serving some awesome cool web application. And I do that with just a couple of lines Terraform code. So before I go to explain the Terraform code, I just increased a little bit. It's okay. So what I now go to do is first to plan my chains. So I just execute in Terraform plan. Hopefully it works because I need internet connection. So now it is just fetching and updating the state from Amazon. So this is the most, it takes long. No. Do I have network? I think so. Oops. Oops. I just kill it. Moment. That's quite unlucky.
Is there another network?
Okay, no.
I think this is not going to be faster.
It was working this morning. I otherwise I just continue. Yes, there it is. The hotel Wi-Fi works. So now it is just executing the change and I go to explain what's happening. We'll be fine. So what's happening here is we go to recreate just a simple web application with Terraform, where we spin up just an EC2 instance and we create a security group to open the port 80 to our instance. So we have only to define a couple of lines in Terraform code. We define the AWS provider, which is just this few lines of code. This one is running in UAE West. And then we define the security group, which is, again, so the port. We add in tags so we can easily find back our resource. And we define the AWS instance. This is just our web server where some magic code is running. And we define an AMI, which is used, an instance type. Micro is good enough for us, so it's not that big. And we can connect the security group to this resource. And Terraform will, based on those kind of connections, calculate a tree and try to execute it in the fastest way it can. So it creates the security group first, and next it creates the instance. So if we go back to this simple demo, we see it outputs an IP address where the instance is running. And if I'm lucky, yes, this is working. So now we have just a simple Hello World application deployed, which is not very magical. So we continue. Important and what's very helpful is to tag every resource in Amazon, because at the moment you start up multiple environments, it is very hard to see where resource from which environment is part. So tagging everything consistently really helps. So moving on to a little bit more real world scenario, this is just more or less the way how we do it nowadays. I changed a couple of things to keep it a little bit simpler for today and to be able to share everything through public channels. So the code of everything, the components, the software, and the infrastructure is on GitHub. Everything is versioned and tagged. There is an automated build that builds all the software components as a Docker image. Those Docker images are pushed to a Docker registry. And then we create a cloud in Amazon with ECS, so the Amazon Container Service. Example is again on GitHub. So that's the build ship part first, so building the container. And that's not, we do that for a Java-based microservice. We will deploy two microservices today. One is a simple GraphQL service. The other one is a very simple service that only tells us in which Amazon region we are running. Next, we build the software with standard Java build tool and Docker. And then we ship the image just to Docker Hub. So we can do that all with six lines of code. Those six lines of code are building the container that we need to run. So the first two lines are for building the software. We do that in a development container. And the next lines copies the artifact to a runtime container. So this is the Docker multi-stage build file. Okay, so that building and shipping is easy, and running as developer is also easy, because as developer, it works on my laptop easily. Just a simple Docker Compose and everything is running. I can just inspect the log from Docker Compose, so everything is there. And when we move on to a production-like environment, it becomes a little bit more complex, because things are not exactly the same. We are not able to spin up simple and Docker Compose. Well, how do we manage our logging? Is discovery working in the same way? What do we have to do for security? So that situation becomes a little bit more complex. So have a look on how we did define it. So we start with a network layer. So we define the complete network layer in Amazon. This is just an example based on the Amazon scenario 2 network layer, where you have a public and private part in your cloud. So you define a VPC. Inside the VPC, you define private and public subnets. The private subnets are only accessible from inside your cloud, the publics from the outside. We will have running from each availability zone one private and one public subnet. So in the example that I will show, we have three availability zones, which means six subnets, three private, three public. Then define the code for that. It's just how it in general looks like. So we define a couple of resources with a lot more properties than I can put on one slide. And then we have the first part of the VPC, and then we have to define the subnets as well. And so we have to do for each subnet, we have to define those resources. And that becomes a lot of code. And typical in our case, that's code that we use in many projects, because the projects has typically their own Amazon account and has to spin up their own VPCs and network layer. So this kind of component in this code is very reusable. So we define it in a reusable component, a module, and then we can define a VPC with just a few lines of code. So instead of having 70 lines of code or so that we have to put in each project, we can define a module and version it in Git. And then we can just link it to our own code. So here we just use a module that defines the VPC that was on the previous slide. So it's only a few lines of code where I can have optional variables, the below one, and maybe mandatory one like the region. So abstracting common code parts in version models is something that works for us very good and speeds up our process a lot. Organizing the code is also an important topic if you go to use this with multiple teams. So what we typically do is one repository per external module for Terraform. Every artifact that we deploy has its own repository, so it is easy to manage and to change, to version and to test. And we organize our Terraform code as well. And that's more the de facto standards nowadays. So we have a main file which contains all the resources, a variable file that contains all the variables, an output file for all the output variables, and the same for the modules. So the Terraform code is not easy to test. Yeah, you can execute it in a test environment, but yeah, then you have to spin up everything. There are a few things that you can do. Terraform has built-in support for validation, and there are linters available that check for best practices in your code. So then we have to plan this. So now we're just executing this VPC infrastructure, and it is created a plant in a few seconds. And then the next step is applying. This is a little bit on higher speed, but normally takes 2 minutes or so. And once finished, we have our VPC available. So the next step, so we have this now available in our cloud. The next step is that we want to have want to add our containers to this, because we all do this to get our immutable infrastructure to serve our software or our products. So we have to put our containers in, and those are in the ECS block. And what ECS is just normal EC2 instances with an agent installed from Amazon, which turns the cluster into a container cluster. And then you can just define your containers inside the cluster. So again, we have to define a bunch of Terraform resources. We don't like to repeat ourselves continuously. So we define quickly a module where we only have to pass through typical couple of parameters from the VPC and the region, and then we can easily spin up a module that creates those EC2 instances. And you can add all kinds of scaling parameters as well. Also, logging is taken into account, so all logging goes by default to CloudWatch, but you can easily also send it to Elasticsearch, which is a lot more convenient to use. So the next step is that we need our containers there, and containers are running in Amazon as a service, and the service contains a task, and the task is actually the container itself. So again, a couple of resources, and we extract that to a module, and in this way we can define multiple servers in more or less the same way. So we only have to define the image name, the version typically, we give the service a name, and we have to tell on which, I think, which port it is running. It's even not in this example on the slide, but the port should also be there. So if we do this, then we can easily create our services. So a couple of important things that we learned here is we really try to choose defaults for our modules, which makes them very easy to use by all the teams that are using our modules nowadays. And they have defaults that in most cases work. And if the default is not working, then just overriding. And Terraform is a declarative language, so there are some tricks to do some conditionals. So for example, if you want to spin up a Bastion host, yeah, you can comment out the code, but you can easily also use some conditionals and count together to get it conditional. But that's more the real tricks. So we plan this again. It's already planned. It says only go to add a few resources because we didn't make any change. We go only to add to our already existing VPC. So we apply it on high speed. And once this is done in a few seconds, we have two servers available. One that is hosting our GraphQL microservice, and the other one is hosting a simple service that tells us which region we are running. I have some time, yeah. So we go to demo this, some more demo. We go to try to scale our service a little bit. It's not something that you normally want to do manually, but for the demo today is the most easy thing to show. I increase it a little bit. So what I have here running is the microservice that is just telling us in which region it's running. And we see it's only running in one region. So we go to scale this one. So here we have the code for this service. So it is only a few lines, as you see. And it is desired count is one. So we just increase it to 3. We plan. And this will just calculate what is going to change in our infrastructure. And if I'm lucky, it goes to tells, it goes from 1 to 3. And there's the result. So it goes indeed from 1 to 3. So we go to apply this as well. So now it is executing this, and this will take some time. So we keep it here running, and I can continue with my last slides. And hopefully it will shortly go, we will see 1A and 1C. So the Terraform heavily used a state file, and that state file is, if you do nothing, it's just on your local. And if you work with a team, that doesn't work. So Terraform also has built-in support to manage your state in a backend, and then you can use S3 console or Terraform Enterprise or build something yourself. So it is important that you keep your state in a central way. So if one person in the team is working on it, the other person gets the same state. It supports out of the box locking if you share your state. So it avoids that you're doing things with two people on the same time. Yeah, we typically have to manage multiple environments, so dev staging live, and sometimes even over different regions, different Amazon accounts, and we can easily do that with abstraction with a couple of environment parameters. We can easily use the same code for the different environments. And again, models works here again quite good. Oh, it's still working. No, we will see. Some other tools that are handy to keep in mind is if you start writing models, it's also important to have right documentation. There's a simple tool available that generates markdown documentation of all your parameters of your models. And then you have a simple overview of the documentation of this module, including all the defaults that you have set. Terraforming is a tool that can help you to import existing infrastructure in Terraform, including state. And the last thing that is there is there's a GitHub repository of Terraform community modules, and that are very handy modules also for VPCs to get up started very rapid. Now we see it is now the service is running also in other regions or in other availability zones, so the scaling had worked. So yeah. That's all. If you want to read a little bit more, I put everything is on my blog, so that you can find the slides back and all the examples and references to GitHub. And you can try it out easily yourself. All comments are there explained. So thank you for your attention.
Question time. Who's the first? Okay. We'll get to the second question.
How do you think, what's the, let's say, major advantage of Terraform against, like, for example, Cloudify? I mean, Cloudify has, like, YAML configuration files, so you don't have to learn, like, this HCL, which is, like, only for HashiCorp products.
Yeah.
Don't you think it's, like, more easier, much convenient?
But which tool did you mean?
Cloudify.
We never had a look on Cloudify, but yeah, we compared for this we compared Terraform and Cloud Foundry, CloudFormation, and yeah, CloudFormation was for us seems not to be working, and we even couldn't manage to create our S3 buckets with CloudFormation. And since we also want to try out OpenStack in a few months, we choose for Terraform. So yeah, for us it works.
Okay.
But and even Terraform is still in a very early stage, so they are in, I think, 0.10 release, and we start in with 0.6, and all the migrations were more or less painless.
What kind of provisioner you use for the instances you created with Terraform? Which tool you use for provisioning then?
We don't provision.
I mean, like Chef or Ansible? No,
nothing. It's out of the box Amazon Linux with an Amazon container instance, and that's all. And if we have to upgrade the instance for some reason, we just remove the old one automatically and spin up a new one.
Okay,
so
thank you.
So we don't do any provisioning. Everything is part of the container.
Okay, we have one more question here.
Hi, Hi. My question is, I have some experience using Terraform, and besides that, heat, and hear about cloud formation. I have some doubts if for my experience, Terraform not have monitoring tools in it, not have integration with monitoring tools in AWS. So if you use CloudFormation, you can auto-scale, auto-heal group, and it automatically spin up new VM when load increase. But is Terraform, no.
No, in Terraform, there's no out-of-the-box support for monitoring, but you have to define your conditions with resources and create them with Terraform and Amazon. That's the only way you have.
Okay, so how do you manage when your resources dies or something happens or load increase?
I think we were not running yet into those kind of problems, but we just define alarms if things are going wrong, and that's enough for us nowadays.
Yes, and besides that, I found if you change your mind and change some parameter on instance, Terraform just wipe down all instances and then create it again.
Yeah, but you can, that's correct, but then if you want to create them in such way, you can also define that you want to create the new ones before you destroy the old one. So then you can have a rolling upgrade.
That's what I step at when try to use Terraform.
Yeah.
It's just inform public.
All right.
But it depends on what you change for the instance.
Yeah.
If you change AMI, of course it will be strange.
Of course.
But if you want to change number of CPUs, it will just
that's another type of instance.
All right, we have a discussion unwinding. I think we can continue after, and now let's thank Nick again. Huge round of applause.